Hello everyone, thank you very much for joining this event. Today we are going to discuss a few approaches in profiling that you can't usually do with a free profiler. That's why I've chosen for today's event to use JProfiler. We will discuss about these techniques and when are they useful, which are the things you can do if you don't have them, and I hope you will enjoy the event further. So, as usual, if you are watching the event live, don't forget that we have a live chat there, so you can ask me questions in the live chat. If you are watching the event recorded, you can still follow me on Twitter and LinkedIn, and you can leave me questions in the comment section as well. With that being said, today I've prepared for you some small applications, Spring Boot apps that we will use for our demonstration purposes. We will start with discussing about connections to a relational database and how can you spot leaking connections. Secondly, we'll discuss about call graphs and where can you use call graphs and how are they useful. And thirdly, we will discuss about flame graphs, which again, you will see they are useful in some cases. They help you faster identify hotspots, which is basically in what we call the parts of the code, the parts of the execution that spend more CPU resources, CPU time, and may cause latencies in the execution. In other videos on this channel, I will show you that some of these things can be done using Visual VM as well, which is a free profiler. I do use it a lot, but some kinds of more advanced representations, like the ones that I will present today, are not easy to implement without having a licensed profiler such as JProfiler. And in case you have JProfiler, then it makes sense to benefit of these techniques. And of course, in order to benefit of them, you have to know them first. So that's why we discuss them today. So what have I prepared? Let's start with a first example. So this is just a small Spring Boot application. I won't go into the code as well. The idea is finding out what's behind the scenes without even digging into the code. So that's where profiling is valuable. One of the things that I like most about profiling is that sometimes you don't even need to go into the code to find out what happens behind the scenes. And that's one of the things I would like to make visible today. I use profiling a lot when I deal with muddy code that is very dirty. Sometimes it doesn't even have a class design, it's just very random. I do find these kind of applications when specific companies call me for consultancy and they want to replace a piece of software that is maybe old, maybe not necessarily old, but poorly implemented in the very beginning. And you know that what happens if you don't take care from the very beginning of the app's maintainability, you might end up a couple of years later with an application that you have to rewrite. And I often find myself in these kinds of situations. And guess which is the most difficult thing to do when you have to analyze this kind of an app that you've never seen before, that has no documentation, that has no unit tests, that is very poorly written, of course, reading and understanding what it does. So what does the profiler help me with is understanding what code does without me even having to read code first. I usually, and that's a secret I have, and I'm telling you the secret, when I analyze an application that I've never seen, I say, take a look into the code and I realize that it's poorly written, I don't continue going into the code. I first start with a profiling session. I'm usually sampling first the application, and then I use several techniques to understand what happens behind the scenes, and some of them you will see today. Unfortunately, not in all cases I have the chance to use a licensed profiler. So sometimes I have to deal with this stuff using Visual VM or other free tools, because basically the license and the software depends not necessarily on me, but on the client I'm working with. So I don't pay for the license, they pay for the license usually. So that's why if they don't want to pay, of course I will try to use several other tools which are free, but they might not help me as good as if I would have used the techniques that I will present you today. So of course my advice is do advise your customer to buy a license for such a software if they have the money, but sometimes we can understand that they don't want to do so because JProfiler, at least even in my opinion, is quite expensive. Even an academic license like the one I bought for my presentations costs about $200, which is quite a large amount of money, I would say, counting that I don't do anything with this license. I'm just learning and teaching others. I have an application here. We don't, again, the whole idea, the whole exercise was not taking a look into the code up front. You can see that it has an endpoint. That's everything we need to know. I will start the application and I will show you the behavior. And then we will have to find a way to figure out what happens behind the scenes without looking into the code. And then we will look into the code only when we have identified the problem, and we will directly go to that part of the application with the problem. Do you think something like this is possible? Well, I will show you this is possible. And imagine now another scenario. You have a friend and they call you and they tell you, well, I have this problem, but I have no idea how to investigate it. You, of course, have no idea what the application does at that point. You don't know how it works, but you still, with these techniques, have the possibility to find the issue. So let's see what happens. I have this endpoint, and if I'm going to call this endpoint first time, it returns me something, and we didn't even care what it returns because it doesn't matter for our demonstration. But the idea is that, and you see, it basically returned this in a very, very small time. It's a very small amount of data, nothing special in general. If I call this the second time, it freezes. You will see it staying like this for about 30 seconds. And then it will completely crash with an exception. So that's basically the problem. We want to figure out where it's coming from without even having to look into the code. So the code will be the last thing we are dealing with when applying these techniques. Okay, so it's still a 200, okay, we don't know why, because it's not good, it's an exception, but it's a poorly written application, so that's the scenario, and it has to act like a poorly written application. We see the exception behind the scenes tells us something about Hikari pool, which is the data source we are using, which is the default data source in a Spring Boot project with the standard JDBC configuration, the standard JDBC dependencies. And we see that the message says that the connection is not available, but we've seen that at the very beginning it worked, so it can't really be a configuration problem. So we have to see what actually happens in this case. So we restart the application, and then we will try to profile to see what happens up front. Whenever I start with a proper investigation, I'm usually sampling first, but because I want to spare some time on our session today, I will start directly with profiling, which is also called in some cases instrumentation. So I started the application, and here is my JProfiler behind the scenes. If you want to repeat whatever I show you today, JProfiler also has some weeks free, so it has some period of time where you can test it. You can use that time to figure out and repeat yourself, exercise yourself, repeating after me the same things. So you see here, what I'm going to do is I first, like in any other cases where I'm using a profiler, I'm first of all attaching the profiler to the process I'm profiling. You can find the process by its process ID if you know the process ID. In general, if you profile a Java application, the process name by default will be the fully qualified name of the main class. And in my case, this is the one here. So I'm going to start the profiling. And again, usually, and that's my recommendation, is you start with CPU sampling, which is a lighter way of a profiler. It's in all the profilers you'll find. You will find in Visual VM as well. In a later episode, I will show you how to use sampling and profiling with Visual VM as well. But the idea is simple. So you first start with sampling. And that's why it also says here recommended. Like, you first start with sampling because profiling instrumentation generally spares a lot of resources. So usually when you start to do instrumentation, you have already to know where to focus, what to focus on. So if you don't know what to focus on, profiling the whole application could be even impossible in case of very large applications. Like in my case here, it might work because it's a small project only for demonstration purposes, but in a real world application, things stay a bit different. So you just, let's click on instrumentation in our case. And what I will show you is that, first of all, you can basically start some CPU profiling to see what happens behind the scenes. So when I click on the CPU recorded data, I'm now waiting for the application to do something. And let's basically trigger again the endpoint and see what happens here. What do I get when I profile the CPU the first time? The first time it's when it works. So one of the things you can see here is what we call the execution stack trace. You will have this kind of tool in any kind of profiler. Like even in free tools, you will have an execution stack. It might look a bit different. Sometimes the details are in a different position, but it mainly gives you the same things. So one of the things you will see is how long it took, so the amount of time, the execution time, and the number of invocations, which are, in my opinion, some of the most important details. Sometimes only with the execution time and the number of invocations, you can already do a lot of things. And if you go and you try to analyze how this work, you will see that in the stack trace, like in a normal stack trace, when you can also see in a log file, you will determine which method calls another method. So in my case here, I can see that from the controller level, one service was called, so the invocation was only once, and then the service further called one invocation here for a repository method, and then it's called findAll, and then we have 10 invocations for another repository, which is called findProduct. So you already know a lot of things from the stack trace. So that usually the stack trace is enough. And that's why in some cases, even using free tools, and Visual VM is one of my favorites, it can be enough if you have a bit of experience. But if you either don't have enough experience, or you simply have a very complicated code base that you are investigating, using a stack trace might not be the same easy. Like, remember, here we are looking at a very simple project, which is only for demonstration purposes, but always know that in a real world example, you might have a bigger stack trace, more complex code without a code design, and so on and so forth. So what can you do if you want to better understand what happens behind the scenes here? First of all, I would like to know what is the relationship between objects and methods. And of course, as I've told you, as you might be able to see, we can identify this directly from the stack trace. Again, remember that it's not same easy when you have a more complicated application. So let me show you what I do if I have the luck to be able to use JProfiler in such a case. I'm going to right click it and I say show call graph. And this transforms, it's just a different representation of the stack trace, which is, by the way, it's also called a call tree in JProfiler. It's representing it now in a fashion that focuses more on which are the actors, meaning the objects that are part of this execution, and the relationships between them. So you still have here the time and the number of invocations, which is very important, but this representation is not focusing anymore on hotspots, and this is not focusing anymore on an hierarchic way of seeing the calls. It's simply the relationships, and that makes it very easy to see. Observe that in the call tree, same as in the stack trace, you also have the objects and the methods that are not part of the code base of the application, that are part of the framework you are using. So for example, in my case, this object is most likely the thread that has been created by my Spring application, and then my code base is only this purchase controller, which you can clearly see from the package name is part of the code base of my application. And then I can anytime just go beyond, and I will see exactly the relationships between the objects. And that's I'm not sure how to put it, but in a real world scenario where you again investigate a dirty code base, this is fantastic. So you will see a huge tree, because it will not be as simple as in this case where I'm only presenting you this very small example. We have a service calling a repository and then calling another repository 10 times. So you still see the number of invocations. But even here, as a demonstration, already only seeing this, you can imagine what happens behind the scenes without even having even having to look in the code. So you already know there is a controller. We've seen at the very beginning that's exposing the endpoint. We know further without looking at the code that is calling a service. The service classes usually implement the use cases, and we even know the algorithm, that what happens behind the scenes, because we know that the service first of all called this find all method, and then it called 10 times this other one. So I can already see what happens here. So it should be something like this method called, it returns a list, and then probably we iterate over that list, because it's basically, I think this find all returns 10 elements in a list, and then we invocate basically on every element in the list, and which already gives me a perspective of the algorithm that has been implemented behind the scenes. Of course, in this case, it's not needed, but in some cases, you want to go even further than this and understand further what happens. So in our case, it's not really relevant. It's a very small application from this short part of the call graph. I have already understood what happens behind the scenes. But in some cases, and often in real world scenarios, you want to know more than that. So you have to go further. You will see a larger graph, but it gives you immediately the idea of which objects you have, which are the classes where you have to go. Remember, a real world application, it doesn't only have those classes that you are looking into. It has maybe 1,000 classes. And how do you know where to go when you execute a specific capability of your application? You might not know which is exactly the class you want to investigate, but if you have the stack trace, and even better if you have a call graph, like in the case of using JProfiler here, you have the chance to have a call graph, you see immediately exactly which are the objects and which are the relationships between the methods. So this is the first thing I'm doing. So now I basically have an idea of what happens behind the scenes. And I can tell you that when I see something like this in a real world scenario, like something like a find and then a number of invocations, multiple number of invocations of something on a different repository, I already know that this is most likely a bad design in the application. Usually something like calling a query, querying the database, and then for each record querying again the database in a loop, this is usually a bad implementation. So I already have an idea of what happens behind the scenes without even looking into the code. So let's see, do we have, I have a question in the chat, I will read it. Do we have any Java agent kind of a jar which does this job? I would like to attach it to my CentOS dev server jar and get a dump which can be viewed in my local Windows desktop. So what happens behind the scenes, Vishal, is that the profiler, doesn't matter which profiler you choose, it will attach to the process and it instruments the process. So I'm not sure to what kind of jar you'd like to have, but what a profiler does is basically attaching to a process that you select. I just shown that at the beginning of the video. So you take the profiler. In case you want a free one, Visual VM should be your choice, and you can attach it. It works on CentOS, of course. It works on Linux. It works on Mac, same as JProfiler, and you can use it. I hope that answered your question. And now I'm going back to the call tree here, so you can anytime change back to the call tree. And one other thing you can do is analyze this as a flame graph. So I will now show you what a flame graph is also. So you can show flame graph here. This is how it looks like. It's called a flame graph, and I think now you can understand why the name is a flame graph, is because it looks like a flame, it looks like fire. And why is a flame graph useful is that you can see the layers. This is the stack. So on the vertical axis, you can see the stack. If I have a recursion, for example, it's very easy to see a stack gets very, very tall. So I can easily identify, for example, if a stack gets very, very tall, I might identify that's a problem with a recursion. If it's tall, but it's not a recursion, but it might simply be that we have not a necessarily a proper design, like we maybe have what we call phantom objects in a class design. Phantom objects being objects that don't do anything, they simply delegate to another object, and these are kind of layers in the calls that you need to remove. But even more importantly than this is that you can see, so this is the last, the first, it's actually called the first layer in the flame graph, is basically the method that I'm starting with, and then above the horizontal axis, so what you see on the horizontal line is basically the time that was spent. So it's a relative representation here of the time that was spent on that method. So what the flame graph brings, and it's a great visual perspective, is that you can see the upper methods, the execution time relative to the methods that are below. So you can start with this layer, which is the only one. It only calls one method further, so that's why the first layer just above the find purchase products, which is this one from the purchase service, get products name for purchases. This is the same length. You see the both lines have the same length here. And then the third line in the flame graphs, you see there are two methods. And the fact that this one is shorter and this one is longer is not random. It's because the time spent by this one is shorter than the time spent by the second one you see here. So what's, for example, interesting to observe here in this example is that even though this method was called 10 times, and you can see this in the pop-up when I hover over the method, that we have the details about the total execution time and the number of invocations. So even though this one was invocated 10 times, while the one near it was only invocated once, still the biggest time, so the biggest execution time was spent by this one, which is the find all, and not by the ones that have been repeated 10 times. So what you do further, of course, this is not a case of an example for, it's not a good example for hotspots because it doesn't have hotspots at all. But what you can see with that is basically where is waiting much the execution time? Where is spent the most execution time so we can go directly to the problem in the spot? Why everyone going towards Gradle? I'm not sure what if that's a question. I'm not talking about Gradle here, so hopefully that's not a question for our video. Is it possible to profile an application through SSH because the servers we run do support a GUI? Cool, that's a very good question actually, and the answer is yes. It's not basically through SSH, but you can remotely, what we call, profile an application. That's possible in any profiler. So you can see here, basically, here is the point where you say on another computer. And then if you want through SSH, you can go through an SSH tunnel this way. And you basically have to configure the address to the process that you profile. You actually configure the address to the machine, and then same as you do here on this computer. I don't have an example now for you, but you will select the process you want to profile. However, mind that you need to have the right permissions from the infrastructure and networking point of view. That's one thing which happen very often, that in enterprise applications deployed in an enterprise environment, you might not have all these permissions needed, so you might not be able to link your profiler to the remote process. And secondly, never do profiling on a production environment. So trust me, profiling is something that in 99.99% of the cases you will do locally on your computer. If you really need to profile something, say you have the right permissions and everything, and you can remotely profile a process, do that only on a dev environment, on a lab environment, so never on production, because profiling means also intercepting the code. So automatically, by intercepting the code, the application becomes slower. And it can interfere with the execution, and it can even break sometimes the execution, and you don't want that in production, definitely. So never profile on production services. If you are ever tempted to do that, trust me, think twice. You won't do that. So that's the second representation. So what I do use is a call graph, and that's my best way. If I can use, I use it to identify and understand better in a different visual perspective the design behind the scenes, and I do need that many cases when I have muddy code, and when I have performance problems, like something is slow. One of the best way to represent is using the flame graph, because the flame graph, you see, it shows you exactly, it tells you what to ignore and where to go. Of course, I'm also trained enough, so I've done this for many years, and I'm quite comfortable with using the call tree as well. And that's why in many cases I don't even need to have a licensed profiler such as JProfiler. And again, in many cases I wasn't offered the chance, because JProfiler is quite expensive, so I use Visual VM for this. Again, being enough, say, experienced, I can realize where the hotspot is using a call tree as well, and not necessarily need the flame graph. But in first of all, even if you are experienced, it's still easier with the flame graph, because you see, again, it tells you exactly what takes the most amount of time. So that's where you can see exactly on the flame graph where your execution sticks. Even if you have experience, it's better to have a more comfortable tool to use than not have it, isn't it? So if you have it, why not using it? And if you don't have experience, of course, being more comfortable, the flame graph will most likely help you identify easier the hotspots. We will leave, however, hotspots as a separate subject. So I didn't prepare an example for hotspots. I just wanted to show you these more, say, advanced visual representations, but only treat a specific problem, which is not, in our case, a hotspot. Or at least we can see here it's not a hotspot. And of course, what we wanted to investigate in the end is the problem we had with the fact that when you call the second time the endpoint, so it completely sticks. It stays here about 30 seconds, then it fails with an exception. So what about that? You see here it actually creates a second thread. I think that should be the other thread or not. I'm not sure. Anyway, the idea is that we already, from the logs, somehow identified where the problem comes from. So I think we didn't. Okay, here it is, 30 seconds. And we did identify that the problem here is somewhere going to be a connection that's wrongly created, or maybe it's not correctly managed. And when I do first investigate a problem, when I investigate a normal execution, I'm directly using sampling and profiling. When I'm investigating a problem like I do in this case, I first time go to the logs. Of course, in many cases you have an exception there. Hopefully there are unlucky situations where the exception gets swallowed and you don't see it, but in many cases you see it there, and gives you a good point on where to investigate further. So if you have access to JProfiler, then you also have a possibility to investigate more about the databases, including the connections themselves. So let me do like this. I will, of course, restart the application now, and I will try to start again the profiling session, but this time I will not only start CPU profiling, but I will also start the database profiling. And database profiling is something you can do with Visual VM as well, as again I will show you in a different video, in the next videos I will post on this channel. But Visual VM doesn't know, or at least is not comfortable to investigate connections. You can see a lot of important things such as queries, but not necessarily connections. So another question in the chat: what do we do if we want to figure something out in production? For example, if something takes a long time in prod, or if there is a deadlock somewhere in our application in production. So that's a very good question. If it's something that is production standstill and it anyway affects everyone, then maybe you want to do some profiling, but that's rarely the case. When you have a problem in production, usually you have a problem not with the whole app, because it's strange to believe that you deployed such a big problem. You hopefully test your application first in a local environment or in a lab environment. But I know that it happens sometimes that a specific problem only reproduces in production, because, for example, you have more data there, and say for security reasons you can't simply copy the data and reproduce the problem in lab. So that tends to be a lot more difficult. I will explain very shortly what I would do, but I will explain more details, examples in separate videos about that. First of all, I do try to use logs, and I do try to see through logs what precisely what action is taking a long time. But there it depends a lot what I find out through the logs. So if I deliver I put a more fine logging level and I find out hopefully that a part of the application is the one causing the problem, then I do investigate that part of the problem. Usually when you have a performance problem, there are not a lot of causes, kinds of causes that can be the root cause of that. It can be usually some query on a database that's wrong, and you usually can identify it. And then if it's a query on a database, then you have also other ways in which you can investigate it. Like you can take that query and you can do some You can do some explain plan directly for it, and usually the explain plan in a DB client will show you that you maybe missed an index or maybe there is a better way to write that query. It can be that it's an I/O communication, like you try to read from a file, write to a file, read from a socket, write to a socket, read from an endpoint, call an endpoint, and then you have to figure out why that endpoint is slow. It might not even be your problem or your app's problem. It might be an endpoint that you call from another partner system, and then they have a problem and you have to report it. So this is a difficult art. It's not with a defined recipe. But anyway, whatever you do in production usually is not with profiling, remote profiling or remote debugging, because they do affect the execution anyway. So if you do that, you might get more problems than you try to solve. So I hope I answered your question with that. I was basically trying to attach again. So I restarted the application. I will attach again my profiler, and then I will say instrumentation, and I will CPU record. But then I'm going to a database as well, and then start recording. And you see here, I have two tabs that refer to connections. One of them is called connections, and the other one is called connection leaks. So what are the connection leaks? Connection leaks, a connection leak happens when a connection is not closed. When you work with a relational database, a database management service, the database management system allows you to open a finite number of connections. Usually it's not a big number, maybe 100, let's say. So you have your app has the possibility to open a max 100 connections, maybe even smaller the number. But the idea is the following: if you open connections but don't close them, then at some point you will have spent all the possible connections you can open. And then if that happens, the DBMS won't allow your application to open other connections. Usually what happens in such a case is that the app will try to open a connection, and if hopefully some timeout was configured, it will crash after the defined timeout. And why I say hopefully is because you should have a timeout always in such cases, otherwise you will not even spot the issue and the application will hang and it will become a lot more difficult to investigate. Having a failure is better than not having a failure, and that's what we call usually a fail fast approach. We prefer the fail fast. We prefer the app to fail rather than hang, because if it fails, we know, immediately find out where the problem is and it's easier to solve. If it hangs, it's much more difficult to find the problem. So remember that a timeout can save lives in some cases. A connection leak means you don't close the connection. So let's see if our application has such a problem. So I will call again my endpoint. And what you will see is that basically the app tries to open 10 connections, which already gives me some clue that we do have some leaking connections here, because I see here a first one somehow seems to have two events, which means that most likely it was opened and closed, but the other ones only have one, so they have been opened, but they don't seem to have been closed. So here, if I go to the connection leaks tab, I will confirm my suspicion, and these connections remained unclosed. For the call of an endpoint, it's rather strange to have connections unclosed 40 seconds after the endpoint already responded. So that means in this case, we are definitely looking at a connection leak problem. The project uses H2, so 10 is the maximum number of connections. So that's why second time when I call the endpoint, it doesn't work, because the first one has already spent all the possible connections, the 10 connections. And you will see now, we will look into the code and you will see what is the problem. But I promised you that we do look in the code only when we have already figured out where the problem comes from with the profiler. And the idea is that it's quite easy to see where the problem is using JProfiler, because if you started the CPU sampling and when you identified the JDBC communication, the connection and the other events that the app sent against the database are also traced, so you will find out a nice stack trace. You can see it here. And the stack trace tells you exactly where this connection has been created. So you see here that this connection that is unclosed, and of course all the others anyway, because it's the same problem. It's the problem that causes this is the same piece of code causing it, is the connection somewhere in product repository find product. So let's take a look in this class product repository and see if this method indeed creates a connection and forgets to close it. I'm going into the code, and here you can see where the problem is. So you see that this connection has been declared before the try with resources. Only the statement seems to be part of the try with resources. The connection should have been as well part of the try with resources, or should have been somehow closed manually on the finally block of this try of this try catch. So yes, indeed the problem is coming from this class. I will keep this one with the problem for later demonstrations. But what I want to show you is also how the profiling session looks like when you don't have the problem. And for that, I have a second project which is identical. The only thing it does different is that it closes the connection. So observe that in this application, it's basically a copy paste of the previous one, just that it closes the connection. So I simply moved the connection to the try with resources block. So I'm going to start this application now, and I will profile this application instead, and you will see how is the execution different comparing to what you have seen in the first example. By the way, you might think that these kind of problems cannot happen today because, well, let's be honest, when the last time actually created a prepare statement, and it was not a theoretical example, I'm not sure, maybe made by you or maybe as an exercise in the faculty. I have people asking this question pretty often, say, well, why do we even have to know how to investigate problems with connections today? Because it can't happen anymore, isn't it? Like in a Spring application, a normal Spring application, you most likely will never get to actually run prepared statements. You will either use JDBC template. Now, in a lot of applications, we do use Spring Data, which can be Spring Data JDBC or Spring Data JPA, if you want to go even a higher level. And that this thing cannot happen anymore, isn't it? Which is not true. Let me tell you a story. So just a few weeks, maybe months ago, I had to consult on a problem where a connection stayed open in a Spring application. And basically, when I started looking into that problem, I figured out that it was something that even with quite some experience with Spring, I didn't know where it comes from. But the idea was that the application itself was borrowing a connection from Spring, and it needed that connection because it needed to do something that you couldn't have done with Spring Data or with JDBC template, which is in this case, canceling the call of a stored procedure. So the application was basically calling a stored procedure, but it also needed to have a low level access to it to be able to cancel it. In Java, to cancel a stored procedure, you simply call on the statement the cancel method, and that will cancel the execution of the procedure or a longer query. But you can't do that, or at least at the moment, I don't know a way in which you can cancel a procedure if you use, say, Spring Data JDBC or JDBC template. So that application really had to take the connection. And it seems that if the connection is taken, is borrowed from Spring in a transactional method, Spring still closes the connection. And that's most likely because of the transactional aspect behind the scenes. For those of you who are not very comfortable with Spring, don't worry if you don't understand my story. You will understand it if you go to my stream, Spring Fundamental stream, and learn more about Spring. But the idea is, in the end, that it's useful to know these approaches. So in that case, in the case of a transactional method, it works. But if you move the connection, basically the same implementation, you do it in a batch approach using Spring Batch, you have to manage yourself the connection. And it seems that the developers implementing that didn't know. I didn't know either. So I have to be honest with you, I didn't know that. But I did find out that's working like that by using a profiler and investigating the connections. In the end, at some point, I realized it's a problem with the connections and we fixed the problem. And that's another point that I wanted to mention, is that I do use profiling a lot to learn new things, because as you will see, profiling helps you not only to see what's behind the code base of your application, but it also helps you see what's behind the code base of a framework you are using. And I'm quite often find myself sampling the execution of an application, for example, to learn how something happens, not in the app itself, but in a framework the app uses. So that's the story. In that case, the problem really was a connection problem, and the developers simply didn't identify it at the developmental level. So it just happened to be found out later, and to find it, we simply used the approaches I've shown you today. So with that being said, let's repeat the same steps, and that's the last thing I'm going to do today. I will sample main, say I want instrumentation, because I want a little bit more than just CPU sampling. I'm going to start the CPU recording, even though that won't be needed anymore now. And I'm going again to start the JDBC sampling. You see connection and connection leaks tabs. And then I'm calling again the method. First of all, you will see that in this case, you can call it as many times as you want. So that might be a point that it doesn't stuck anymore. Secondly, you've seen me clicking a lot of times already on the send button. So I send the request a lot of times, but you see only one row here. And the reason you see only one row is because each connection started but also closed. And you can now see even in the connection leaks tabs that this is empty. So there is no leak connection anymore, which is a good sign that indeed by closing the connection, by putting the connection in the try with resources block, solved our problem. Of course, it's not only connections. Still with this, you can see other things such as the queries themselves, for example, which is something I use pretty often, but that's something that I will show you later in a separate video you can do with a free profiler as well. But yeah, that's what I've shown today. It's three approaches that are not free, but if you can use them, they might save you some investigation time. And they are available with JProfiler. If you have the chance to use JProfiler, you can use them. The call graph, which again, to recap, I use it to identify easier relationships between objects and method, and understand the class design. And I need that, especially when I deal with big muddy applications. Flame graphs that allow me to easier spot problems with latencies. I do use a lot the call tree, and I'm experienced with that as well, but flame graphs help you easier identify these kinds of problems, because you see exactly what takes a long time on the horizontal, and you can see when for example a stack is very tall, and identifying problems with connections against a relational database. Thank you very much for being here with me, and thank you very much for all your questions. I hope this information will be helpful to you, and hoping to see you for next events on the same channel. Have an excellent time further, and have a great time for learning. Cheers!